Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon, Mark.
I want to encourage, we can get closer, feel free to move closer if you like, as we do our opening conversation here. So welcome, everyone, to Sacred Heart Church here in Warren, South, in the beautiful, amazing city of Camden, New Jersey. If this is your first time to this beautiful church, you are most welcome. If you're here some of the time, you are indeed very welcome. And if you're here all the time, you are most, most welcome. My name is Mark Corley. I have the honor to serve as the chairperson of the Board of Trustees for the Center for Environmental Transformation. It's my pleasure to be the master of ceremonies for this event. And I hope not to say too much. I wrote that and then I kept writing and realized I'm going to have to say a little bit more. But I do have some very important things to say. First, and the most important, has to do with the bathroom facilities. That's the most important thing. They are in the basement of this building. If you've never been here before, there's two ways you can go. You can be brave and walk right through here, walk through the back door, go down the stairs, make a U-turn to your right, and you'll get into the basement, you'll be in the kitchen. The bathrooms are over to your far left on that upper level. There's two levels downstairs on the upper level. If you don't want to do that while we're up here talking, you can go out the back door, walk down the side of the church, all the way into the back of it, and then go down the stairs into the kitchen. Okay? So that's where the bathrooms are. Second, we would not be here without the people and organizations that sponsor this event. MAFCO in Camden, which is here in this neighborhood, is a corporate partner of ours and has been for the last 7 years. Ted Fox, Pete and Barbara Pizzatillo, Debbie Durand, Kathy Fox, Kathy Nevins, and the Rabbits family of ShopWays are sponsors of this, as well as Jim and Rosie Hayden. The Rabbits family sponsored the reception, which is downstairs afterwards, and I hope you'll stick around for us. We have some nice refreshments downstairs and an opportunity to talk about what I know will be an extraordinary talk. Third, I must recognize the members of the Board of Trustees of the Center. They're a very talented group of people who are committed to the success of this great work. And I ask them to stand as I call their name. John Levy is our Board Secretary, and stay standing. Bill Harden is our Treasurer. Rosie Haley is our Vice Chairman. Rashida Weaver. Shireen Elisa. Kathy Nevins. Jim Haley. Father Michael Doyle. Where is the funny standing right in front of me? Will Stell. Felicia Lyons. And lastly, Eileen Borland, who sends her regrets. She couldn't be here today. So thank you. Can we have a round of applause? Fourth, I want to recognize the people without whom the idea of this day would have remained just an idea. And I start with Kathy Nevins, who is the chair of this committee, and is one of the most persistent people I know when it comes to making a dream a reality. So thank you, Kathy. I also want to recognize Ted and For those of you who haven't been here, I know there's a big screen, but later on if you walk up, or maybe you've already noticed, there are stuffed animals all over the place. Tomorrow, is, at least in the Catholic, at least in our diocese, we celebrate life tomorrow, and so the children take over the liturgy here, and so we decorate it appropriately. So if you're not doing anything tomorrow, 8:30 or 10:30, you're welcome to join us. It's very hard for me to believe that 10 years ago, this month, 300 people from this church gathered in the basement to dream about the future. One of the dreams born that day was that we would engage environmental issues in our neighborhood, city, and region. After 2 years of monthly 2.5-hour, 3-hour meetings, the Center for Environmental Transformation was born. Soon after that, we started this annual lecture in honor of Father Thomas Barrett, a hero and inspiration for our work. This is our 7th. It's a jubilee year. Jubilee in the Judeo-Christian tradition is incredibly important. Jesus himself announced a jubilee in his first act of public ministry. He said, "Free the prisoners, visit the sick, heal those who are wounded, and preach the good news to the poor." So it's a year when we reestablish all relationships on the basis of mutual love and respect. And we do that even with creation. Are we ever in need of a jubilee? Thank you so much for coming to join us for this event and for your support for the work of our center. So to tell you more about that work, I invite our executive director, Teresa Nieta, to come forward. As she makes her way up here, I must say that Teresa has been a blessing to the center from the moment she arrived in November of last year. So she's in her 11th month as the executive director, our very first, and we are very happy to have her. Teresa.
Whether you're interested in volunteering in one of our 3 urban gardens. who's been critical and also, I would say, a blessing to us. And he's been here about not even nine months ago, since February. So I'd like to introduce him and have him talk a little bit more about our youth programs.
Heartening and important. It feels like we're coming together, a across religions, cultures, communities, and indeed humanity to do the work that must be done now. We can't wait any longer for our political leaders to develop the bravery and commitment to change our course as humanity is suffering now. The ecosystems are being affected now. And the future of all of us and of all of our grandchildren is already being determined now. Sister Mary Elizabeth is one of the bravest people I know. Her commitment to Earth and educating people, challenging public officials, speaking for those who have little voice or for us who are trying to find ours, is consistent through all her work. As director of the Earth Center at Chestnut Hill College, she has developed programming to teach teachers how to teach Earth literacy to our children. She has worked for sustainability at the college. She has worked to spread her courage and commitment through her writing, public speaking, and her insistence that Earth cannot wait for us. We must work together now. She is a perfect choice for today, this year, this moment. I'm pleased to read her official biography to you. I hope you'll get to know her today and speak with her at the reception after the talk. She's here to help us work together on the most important work we will ever do. Just listen to this. Don't blush. She's okay. She's awesome. Sister Mary Elizabeth Clark.SSJ, Sister of St. Joseph, Philadelphia, has been director for the past 5 years at the Sisters of St. Joseph Earth Center, Chestnut Hill, Philadelphia, PA, and a special assistant to the president of Chestnut Hill College for Sustainability. She has collaborated with Chestnut Hill College in initiating a certificate program in spirituality and sustainability in both the undergraduate and graduate schools of the college. She also serves as an ambassador for the U.S. Catholic Bishops Climate Change Coalition. There are only 25 of them in the whole United States, and one of them is sitting here. Mary Elizabeth earned her B.S. in Education from Chestnut Hill College, her M.A. in Religious Studies from St. Thomas Aquinas University in Rome, and her EDS, Educational Specialist degree from Seton Hall University. She served as Social Justice Committee Coordinator for the Sisters of St. Joseph Philadelphia for 9 years. While in that position, she served on the national boards of Network and of the Interfaith Center on Corporate Responsibility. And she hired Sister Simone Campbell, nuns on the bus. Mary Elizabeth participated in 10 days intensive training at Genesis Farm and fostered an appreciation of the new universe stories in workshops and educational presentations. Mary Elizabeth served as a lobbyist with Network, a national Catholic social justice lobby in Washington for seven years. Sister Mary Elizabeth participated in Church Monitors for Peace, sponsored by the World Council of Churches and the Vatican Justice and Peace Commission prior to the election of President Mandela from South Africa in 1993, and on the fact-finding delegations to South Africa and El Salvador. She worked as staff in the Beyond Renew program at the Department of Human Concerns in the Archdiocese of Newark for 7 years. And for 18 years, she taught as an elementary school teacher in parochial schools in Philadelphia, in Newark, and around the corner in Pennsylvania. She has several books and writings that are downstairs for sale, lots of information to get you started and going and keep going, and we are blessed, blessed, blessed to have her here today. I'm gonna ask her. We're going to watch a short 2-minute video first to get us all ready for the first talk, and then she will come forward. And when she comes forward, raise the roof.
Thanks. really appreciate that. I mean, listening to the history, you think, but she's still alive. Thank you. And before I begin, I just want to say how I got to be here. My history is mostly social justice. When I was in South Africa, before President Mandela was elected, I had the opportunity to go to the townships and to monitor the peace with other church monitors because it was a very violent situation. And I met Ursula when I was in the townships. Ursula came, I went to Ursula, who was in a shack, a tin shack, no running water, no heat, no anything that we, but she looked like you or me, and she was a student leader. That's what reminded me of Ursula when I met you at a distance. I went up to Ursula and I said, "Ursula, how do you do this?" She was a student leader. They had protests. The school, they stopped going to school. The high school students stopped going to school because of the apartheid system. And so I said to Ursula, "How do you do this?" And she started to whisper. And I said, "So you come out every day and you gather your friends and you talk." And then I said, "Why are you whispering?" And she said, "I was tortured and my vocal cords were cut." And so she had no voice. So she said, "Now you are my voice. You go back to your country and you tell them what you saw. And you tell them how important sanctions are." Because at that time, our country did not cooperate with sanctions. And so Ursula, with nothing, she had nothing as far as this material world is concerned, is saying to me, "Now you are my voice." And I had an umbrella with me. I thought, I have to stay connected to this person. And I gave her my umbrella. I mean, you know, it's like a big help, right? And then we continued to correspond through her community-based phone. That was the only way we could communicate. She had to go to the community center at a certain time. I would call, and she would talk to me from there. And so, how does that connect with tonight? Well, then I saw, maybe 10 years later, I saw a DVD about the Pacific Islanders who are losing their homes, their whole culture of thousands of years. And I looked at the faces of those Pacific Islanders and I thought, those are my Ursula today. They were saying, "Unless you people of the North do not change your dream, we of the Pacific Islands and all the coastal regions are going to lose, are already losing our lands, our culture, unless you do something about global climate change." So that's where I come from in terms of motivation. There is no disconnect for me with social justice and environmental justice and spiritual fulfillment. And so I have gone for training, so to speak, or education to Genesis Farm, and that's now about 35 years old. But I am so happy that you are promoting and keeping the dream of Father Thomas Berry alive. Yeah. Thomas Burry, who died in 2009, maybe some of you were at his memorial service, is unique in his approach to environmental justice. So I just want to applaud you for keeping his dream alive. And what is that? It's that, in a nutshell, Earth is organic. It's a living organism. It's not a thing, and it's not something that we can treat as an object, but as a subject. And that difference, if you look at everything through the lens of Earth as living, and we as one among many species, not apart from, but together with other species, they are our brothers and sisters, that lens is going to change everything. Everything becomes a subject. We don't call Earth it, we call it her. It's Mother Earth. We treat her as a living organism. And even in things like calling land property, you have to catch yourself. What does that mean? Land is living. Native American people understand how land is not ever sold as property. But we talk about land as if it were an object or a property that we have control over. And we need to start stripping ourselves of that way of thinking. We have to begin to connect with Earth as a living organism. So, I went off script. So I do a script. I do a script because it keeps me focused. That didn't work.
Well done.
I'll get back. Okay. So, in the spirit of Thomas Ferry, we can say we're part of a great turning. You've heard that expression. Joanna Macy uses it. It's a great shift. We're part of the shift. We want to be part of the shift. And it's a new way of being, of interacting with all other species of life on this planet we call home. So it's a new way of being together. Now, we're fortunate to have just had Pope Francis given an unparalleled call to us in a manner in which Thomas Ferry taught. Now, Pope Francis has not quoted Thomas Ferry. However, he is very close to the teachings of Thomas Ferry. He is a scientist, he's a chemist. So he, in a way, gets it. And all of us need to do better in terms of our interconnection with all other species as created by God, the Great Spirit. We're one family of life. And no matter what faith tradition we come from, as we heard Kathy just speak about, we're called to be more deeply rooted in caring for our common home. Now, do you remember the story in the Christian scriptures of the fig tree? A person had a fig tree growing in the vineyard, and Jesus came looking, or the vineyard owner came looking for fruit, but found none. Then he said to the gardener, listen up, look here, for 3 years now, I've been looking for figs on that tree, and I found none. Cut it down. Why should it use up the ground? The gardener replied, leave it for one more year so that I may dig around it and I'll add some fertilizer and perhaps it will bear fruit from now on. And if it doesn't, you can cut it down. So the farmer is trying to save the fig tree, but, you know, it has to bear fruit. So let us imagine another vision. Once upon a time, there was a group of humans called Catholics in the United States. United States. They had arrived there from Europe and had had their first mass in 1526. They thrived as more and more Catholic immigrants arrived on the shores. Thousands of men and women religious founded hospitals, schools, orphanages to minister to Catholics as they were persecuted by others. The role of the laity was emboldened by the teachings of Vatican II, and many lay Catholics began to take up their roles as leaders in the church. Remember this history?
Yeah.
Now, fast forward to today. Imagine the 69.4 million members of the Catholic Church in the largest body of religious in the United States. 69.4 million, comprising 22% of the population of the United States. Now, I'm saying Catholics because as an ambassador for the U.S. Catholic Climate Covenant, I never see another Catholic in the interfaith efforts for global climate change that have been going on before Pope Francis came. But I'm telling you, I look around and I don't see another Catholic. So that's why I'm saying Catholic. And if there are people that are not Catholic here, then you need to help push the Catholics. Because right. Catholics,
yeah!
Are not known for speaking out on this topic. But we're 22% of the population, that's what I want to say. However, the influence of our numbers for social justice and earth justice have been much fainter than 22% of the population. That should be 22% of every effort of interfaith groups. Until now, with the teaching of Pope Francis on his encyclical Laudate Si on care for our common home, then something miraculous is going to happen. One by one, these Catholics became so conscious of the part they could play at this most critical time when Earth's ozone layer is dissolving, peak oil has already happened and passed us by, and the warnings about global climate change were rampant, that they decided they would rise to the challenge as a group and do everything in their power to respond to these warnings. This is us, this is you. They chose to act as one. No longer would they take natural resources for granted or use fossil fuels and water indiscriminately. Every local parish committed itself to recycle everything possible. Driving cars soon became a thoughtful decision. Carpooling became the norm, and public transportation was no longer a novelty. Praying together included concern for Earth's survival, and each of them took on a practice of connecting with other groups who were working on ecological sustainability. Soon, Catholics were known as agents for change for Earth's survival, and all over the world they were connecting with others to work together for the fig tree's one more year of life. Through their practice of prayer, fasting, and almsgiving, they felt the action of God moving through them. It was a miracle. So here we are today, the weekend after Pope Francis shared our man with us, spoke with us in our own cities, challenged our lawmakers and the world's most powerful legislative bodies, ate our hoagies in Philly, spoke with prisoners, people who are homeless and marginalized in our society, as well as with our church leaders and all of us. He called for our best selves to rise to the call. How can we not act? We must. As Pope Francis says, it is no longer an option. It is a moral imperative. And it is an integral ecological mandate. For this mandate includes love of all creation, the human as well as all other species of life, the water, air, and land. We are asked to be our brother and sister's loving companion on the journey. We are asked to do all in our power to influence the systems that keep a consumerist lifestyle in place. Now, think about it. The greed of those who have much cannot continue to rule the marketplace. But it will if we do not do our part. All of us together must make the demands that are needed to change the systems that maintain our comfortable lifestyles. Even when we are blind to our situation and cannot actually see it, we must change to become aware. It's a conscious choice to become more aware. When people say, "I don't know what to do," that's a cop-out, because we can learn what to do. Pope Francis does not let anyone off the hook. He smiles so sweet, he smiles. But he is saying the hardest things we've ever heard as a capitalist consumerist society. He minces no words. And when he was told he might embarrass the United States, has no intention of embarrassing. He's just speaking the truth, and he is speaking it with love. To those who would espouse a capitalist market system, which is the hallmark of our U.S. economy, he challenges us to re-examine its principles of unbridled production, unjust wages, and environmental destruction. Those are the hallmarks we export when we send our multinational corporations overseas, and they get taxed. They get out from under the tax laws here. They get out from under the EPA's regulation here to destroy Earth in other places, which will just come back to us in the long run. No economic system can be considered good unless it asks these questions. Who is hurt by it? Who benefits by it? And our Holy Father says that we are not committed to an ideology, but to a person, to Christ, to Jesus Christ. We're not espousing communism, atheistic communism, but we are espousing Christian communism. When did that go out? That's never been changed. But Marxist or atheistic communism, yes. Capitalism, the ideologies are both broken. So neither capitalism nor communism can be held sacrosanct. We need to look beyond what the market system demands and change our habits and patterns of behavior. We cannot do this unless we are on fire with love. That fire burns in the hearts of each of us who believe we have been created in the image of God 15 billion years ago. We believe it is the image of God, the God of love, that is being tarnished every time we lose a species to extinction and our lands, our oceans rise over our lands. We are losing another revelation of the face of God. And how great it is that you young leaders, farmers, are handling that image. You are handling the image of God. You are cultivating and respecting and reverencing that image. We have a history in the United States of our own bishops writing, teaching about peace. harmony and the economy? And how have we taken them to heart, those documents? Are we ready to examine our own personal lifestyle, our communal Catholic Church lifestyle, and our U.S. societal lifestyle? Can we be humble enough to admit that we need to be converted and to change? Is this a new time? Are we ready to allow ourselves to change our habits? In AA, Alcoholics Anonymous, the first step to turning around from an addiction is to acknowledge that the substance has control over us. Can we acknowledge that consumerism or entitlement has control over us? Can we form small groups of support? We know, as in the case with weight loss, we need support groups. Drug addiction, any addiction, there is no difference here. As a society, we have become unaware of our addiction to oil, to materialism, to everything has to be new. They call us the throwaway society. We need a wake-up call. And Pope Francis has given it to us in the encyclical Laudato Si. I like to imagine three levels of transformation within each one of us. I like to picture the face of Ursula, that young adult leader in South Africa, prior to the election of President Mandela. Ursula stood outside her mud hut in the township of Durban, outside of Durban, as I spoke to her about her situation. And she, as I mentioned before, had been tortured. Her vocal cords were severed. She no longer had a voice. And now she is saying, "You are my voice." That was in regard to social justice. She says, "Go back and tell your people and your legislators to join the rest of the world in helping to free us." Now, fast forward to the film of Rising Waters, which is a film about the Pacific Islanders. The people in those islands are our Ursula today. They're asking us to do something for them. I also heard an Inuit woman from the Arctic pleading with us, people of the continental United States, to change our wasteful ways. If you've ever seen some recent pictures of the Arctic peoples, the Inuit peoples, they're losing their whole culture. And our behavior is part of the cause, and they know that. She pleaded for her people and her land, her culture, and her whole way of life that is already disappearing in the Arctic. We see images of the refugees in Syria desperately begging for help and places to live. We can only imagine the millions of people on coastal regions who will find their homes underwater very soon. These images are no longer figments of our imagination, but are the reality of our own day. As Catholics and other people of faith, we gather this day to remember Father Thomas Berry and his legacy of a new universe story, one that has given us a scientifically sound reason to know that we are all one. Now we know scientifically through the Hubble telescope that our origins are the same. The elements 14 billion years ago that created the stars are the same elements in our bodies, every living organism. We are one. It's not we're becoming one. We are one. We breathe the same air. We drink the same water and root ourselves in the same land. Pope Francis reminds us of our common home. We are the only species who can decide whether or not to destroy it or allow it to flourish. Economist Jeffrey Sachs, who just spoke in Philadelphia last week, and scientist Jean have given us the facts. We don't have the time we thought we had. 5 years ago, they thought we had more time. But we do now have the time we need to lessen the impact. We can't reverse anything. We can't make it the way it was. Earth will never be how it was before, 100 years ago. So what keeps us from taking the action we must? What keeps us from transformation of mind, heart, and spirit? Could it be our own disbelief? Could we just not know what to do? Are we still waiting for someone else to do something? What is the reason we keep moving toward destruction? Just as in the case of a person with any other addiction, we must examine our lifestyles. We must humbly pray for self-awareness and the courage to act. We know we cannot do it alone. We need each other. We pray for open minds. Our hearts and our wills will move forward only together. And to believe that this is the most serious issue of our times. In the document of Laudato Si, Pope Francis says, global climate change is the most serious human rights issue. The most serious. We are the ones who can give water, new life, rich fertilizer to the fig tree so that it can once again bear fruit. Will we?
I'd like you to just turn to one other person for this first exchange and see if you could answer this question. What do I need to do on a personal level? And how can I increase the power by doing something with others? So communal action. And third, how can I influence a system, no matter what the system, church system, political system, economic system, educational system, justice system, prison system, banking system, doesn't matter. All the systems need to be influenced for change. So just reflect for a minute on the three levels of transformation. Personally, each of us have to act on the three levels. We can't look to neighbor and say, oh, well, he's taking care of that for us. He's working on the farm. That's good. No, he cannot do it without us. So I have to be alive and moving. I have to be with others, acting, and I have to influence the system. So we point the finger at ourselves in transformation. We're each asked to act on these three levels. So if you would just share that with one other person, and then we'll open the floor.
Thank you.
much greater, with much greater influence when we work together. So remember, we go back 14 billion years, and in the story of the universe and Thomas Berry's unfolding of that for us, we're not talking tiddlywinks. You know, this is big. This is the universe level. So we need to think of the three levels, each of us, personal, communal, and societal. And I say, you know, that the Christian is really good. I think Christians, Catholics, are really good at the personal and the direct service, the emergency action. It's right here, right now, in front of me. I feel good, you feel good, I help, you're helped. It's all good. And we stay there because it feels good. And we have to do it. There's no question. It's one level of Christian response to social concern. But there are two more levels. There's the second level, which is, it makes a big difference if I do it together. If you're working the garden and you're doing it alone, how fun is that? No. It's a lot of work, right? So you need companions, and you need to have a group. So here's a group. Is that all you have for the farm? Just the three of you? Okay. You get your friends. By communal action. And the third level is influencing the systems. Now that's not just for some people. If each of us have a call, a responsibility to influence the systems. Now I'm talking to the choir here at Sacred Heart. I know you have been doing this for eons, and I've come here for other events and so on, New Year's Eve, and I have been here to experience the awareness, the social awareness. So I'm talking to the choir. But because you are so gifted and blessed, you can't keep that to yourself. You need to be leaders in the Catholic, I say Catholic because they're missing. They're missing from the picture of doing something, really doing something for global climate change. And I think Pope Francis is giving us a big help in making this document for us so we can take it apart, chew it, learn what he's saying, and take it to our lawmakers and our Catholics in Congress. Do you know that the majority of people in the lawmaking bodies of our country are Catholics? That the corporations, the multinational corporations in the marketplace are Catholics. The CEOs all went to Catholic school, right? Ben went to Catholic school, and look what he's doing. I was sitting next to Senator Casey and about the global climate change, and he's a Catholic from Pennsylvania, and so is Senator Toomey, a Catholic. They're on opposite ends of the spectrum for decision making. But I'm a Catholic too, so I keep at it. I keep talking, I keep saying, yes, but you know, the Pope says this. I mean, I use the Pope as my authority, because it's your authority too. And they will, then, you know, and you think about it, it's, we don't speak up enough. And it's part of our social responsibility. We are called on all three levels. So, this talk, the purpose of this was to have practical action. We
want to leave here with action. We want to know what we can do, how we can do it. We want to be motivated by each other to do something. So we know as individuals we're all powerful, power of the Holy Spirit, power of God. In community organizing, power is either organized money or organized people. And now I believe in both. I don't have the money, so I just need money. So, but you, think of it. You wouldn't have the Institute of Ecological Transformation if you didn't have the support of money. So you want to get the money. But you also have people, and network builds its whole organization. The Nuns on the Bus is all about people, getting the word out to the people. So we know that the impact in all of these areas, and each of us is part of each of these areas. Sometimes we get blinders, and we get small-minded thinking. These young people, you're already thinking big. You're already thinking big. Leaders have to think out of the box, big. So like what? Well, you know, in each of these situations where you are, you want to ask the question, how can I reduce the use of energy that I put out? And they call it a carbon footprint. They call it our carbon footprint. The Catholic message is, who is under your carbon footprint? Does everybody know what a carbon footprint is? A carbon footprint, how much carbon am I emitting into the atmosphere? Because that's what's causing the climate change, the problem. So who is under that? The people who are poor, the poorest of the poor, those who probably don't put any carbon into the atmosphere, are the ones who are going to suffer the most, first, and worst, you know, without causing it themselves. So what can we do? How can we stop putting carbon into the atmosphere? So composting, because the reason I put composting there is methane is 80 times worse than carbon dioxide. So we know about carbon dioxide, and we don't want to put carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, but methane produced by landfills is 80 times stronger in destroying the ozone layer than carbon dioxide. So any way we can reduce methane, we want to do it. So by composting, we're keeping food out of the landfill. It gets turned back into soil, which is being eroded by flooding, and we're restoring good soil. So compost is one of the best things you can do. And of course, plastic.
Yeah.
If you think plastic, no plastic. Think getting rid of plastic and all the things that plastic, because plastic is the oil companies. And you think about plastic bottles, and there's a whole island in the Pacific that is nothing but plastic bottles. We gotta get rid of plastic bags, no purchasing of bottled water. Eliminate the purchase. I made that promise, and every once in a while, somebody gives me, and I want to be kind and polite, and I think, oh my goodness, a plastic bottle, I can hardly touch it. But I think this person already purchased it. Okay, so I don't purchase bottled water. And I don't use bottled water if I can control the situation. But I accept it, and then I, you know, try to be sure it gets recycled. But it's the taking pure water from places like India, Indonesia, China, places where people are going to run out of pure drinking water. That is so wrong for us to think we can buy that water, which people have a right to for life. It's going to be gone. And we put it in bottles that are plastic that leach toxins into the water. So think bad. Bottled water, bad. And then think recycle everything. Reuse. This jacket, all these are like rags.
It's like, can I live without anything? I could remake something, I could repurpose it or get it from a thrift shop. So, societal change or systemic change, social justice sounds complicated. Somebody said to me, when you talk about social justice, I just glaze over. Now, I don't think you're glazing over. You are not the glaze over type. I think you're getting it. You are getting it. And societal change has to come from people who are educated, people who know that it's the system who's causing the biggest problems. They want to put it on us and act as if you don't use spray deodorant, that's going to change the world. No. What's going to change the world is if you stop using oil, you know, or promoting all kinds of things that use oil and gas and fossil fuels, that will change. But not just my individual acts are good, but they just make me feel good. I mean, they're not really going to help the whole situation, but the systemic change is really going to go far. And that's why we have to change that attitude of leaving it to the politicians. What has happened is that we have left our responsibility out of the equation, and we act as if elected officials are the only ones who are running this country. And that is very sad. So these are the same old, that you've heard before, but think of them differently. Think of the farmers. Think of taking a group from Sacred Heart Parish to the legislators, including the farmers, including the leaders, including the young people, and including the elders, together to speak to the legislators. What a difference that would make. We've got to think out of the box. What would it look like if your friends, you invited your friends, with the accompaniment of the elders, to go to your local representative, to go to your state senators, and say, we really have studied this issue. We do not want coal-fired power plants running our country. We want you to support the Environmental Protection Agency's clean power plan. If there are simple words that you can get your head around and that you can understand and say, we want you to support this. There is no assurance that this EPA regulation is going to pass. Right now, the president has a position on clean power plants, eliminating some of the coal-fired power plants from our energy source. We want that. But how will they know if they don't hear from you? So I'm just encouraging you to form intergenerational visits to your lawmakers. So you might think in your head, how are we doing? And you're questioning yourself. But you can also put the parish up here. You can put, you know, the institute. You can talk about this in any way and make charts for yourself. How are we doing? Okay, I'll stop purchasing bottled water. That was me. And then I'll invite my family to do it. And then I'll research how to get a water fountain, with a filling station in my workplace, in my school, at Chesterfield College. Do you know we took a survey, we found 50% of the fountains are broken at the college, 50% of the water fountains. So how can we say don't drink bottled water? They can't fill them at a water fountain. So we said, okay, we're 50% broken. The finance director, the vice president, she was shocked. She said, I'm gonna be right on that. Well, that was because the students did the survey, brought the data, did the homework, and that's what we have to do. We have to do the footwork so the legislators know we're with them. We're helping you. You know, you need this evidence so that you'll do the right thing, and then it makes it easier for them. We want them to look good. We don't want to give them a chance. want to do next. This is organizing. And then by when. We don't do things vaguely. Right. Not too vaguely, because it doesn't get done. So you want to be specific. Leadership training. This is a little leadership tip. Don't let your people get away with it, you know. Who's going to do it? And by when are you going to do it? You want to hold them accountable. So what is it you want to do? Why do you want to do it? Who's going to do it? And just a simple chart to help us. And then these are some resources that Catholic Climate Covenant, Catholic Relief Services is already serving the people who are impacted now from global climate change. And then our center at Chestnut Hill College. And downstairs, we have, there are materials. I don't like to take things off on paper so much, but some of these things I only have on paper copies. So I have a list. This is single space, two-sided, of what you can do. And this is parishes, schools, churches, individuals. So that's downstairs. And then there's an interesting paper called Children at Risk in the Womb. Children in the Womb. And that answers some other people's questions. And then how can you help reduce your carbon footprint? Very concrete examples. The Catholic Climate Covenant, who's under your carbon footprint? Actions. A double-sided stapled paper called Sustainable Living, Take Action. 21 things you didn't know you could recycle. Now, some things you shouldn't recycle. They have to be disposed of ethically, carefully. And it tells you where to dispose of them, okay? And then there's a brochure for the Earth Center. There, that's downstairs. And I want you to help yourself to those things. And then the St. Francis Pledge, and Kathy's going to talk about that at another time, but this is downstairs to look at, because tomorrow is the Feast of St. Francis. And then there's some books if you wanted to purchase there on the other side. Thank you so much for your...
Thank you.
trucks. Think of the trucks and how much they use fossil fuel to carry your food to this local supermarket. Co-ops are another way, systemically, sustainable way. Co-ops, or buying local, supporting your local farmers, your local shops and stores is very beneficial. But then getting involved in Interfaith Center on Corporate Responsibility, the corporate entities need to be told. And you can contact the manager, start with the manager, but you can influence the system of whatever the food production is. So that's the whole economic system that can be impacted. But just personally, buy local, buy organic, but sometimes organic is expensive. It doesn't have to be, but buying local is the best thing.
I want to show the talk today. I have a little piece of a poem I'd like to share.
Yes.
For about 1 minute, is that right? It's just because it might be a great reminder how artists can remind us of the joy of doing this work and what we love. We might as well come out already. So this is from a poet named Ross Gay. And the poem is called A Catalog of Unabashed Gratitude. And this is just one section of it, and I'm going to ask Michelle to hold the mic for me because I'm ready to hand. Okay. So, hear ye, can you hear me?
Yes.
hear ye, I am here to holler that I have whole tons, by which I don't mean lots, I mean tons of cow shit, and stood ankle deep in swales of maggots. Swirling the scent of their braids, the brewery man was good enough to drop off, holding his nose, for they smell very bad. They'll make the compost dry, giddy, and lick its lips, twirling down with my pitchfork again and again, with hundreds and hundreds of other people. We dreamt an orchard this way, furrowing our brows and holding our wheelbarrows, and swaying through our shirts. And 2 years later, there was a party at which trees were sunk into the well-fed earth, one of which, a woody apple, after being watered in, was tamped by a baby barefoot with a bow hanging in her hair, biting her lip in her joyous work. And friends, this is the realest place I know. You could ride your bike there, or roller skate, or catch a bus. There is a fence and a gate twisted by hand. There is a fig tree, taller than you, in Indiana. It will make you gasp. It might make you want to stay alive, even. Thank you.
Difficult time getting the DEP to stop, so we're working on that. Also, objections to the pipeline running through the pinelands, all of that stuff. There's also a group called Food and Water Watch, which is a national organization, very good one. It does a lot of good work. And Environment New Jersey is a good one right here in New Jersey. So there are a number of organizations that are doing excellent work and need support and need help and so on. So recommend.
Yes, thank you very much. And just a personal note, our conversation. differently, trying to formulate a philosophical statement about how our relationship to land is different from property, that we don't want to see our land as property, but as a living organism.
I love what you said about people working together on these objectives. One of the highlights that I participated in within the last year or so was that Climate March in New York, the 350.org sponsor. I'm curious how many folks actually went on that march here, anyone? Just a couple, okay. Anyway, there were 400,000 people from many, many different organizations, both in this area and across the whole United States. People came in from other countries, and not only that, but they did similar marches in other places. I was at an event last week, and there was a couple there who said, well, you know, our son was involved in organizing. Close to 1,000 people came from Philadelphia and South Jersey to go to that march. Another group that's very active in this area is Sustainable Cherry Hill. They do some very interesting events. I think there's a food event, an International Food Day, is coming up in about 3 weeks on a Saturday. It's going to be held at one of the high schools in Cherry Hill. We went last year. It was a great event. Unfortunately, we have another commitment this year, so we won't be able to come. But there's lots of good things going on, and Sister Mary Elizabeth, we've worked together in the past, and it was wonderful, and I so appreciate all your comments today. Many good ideas to share. Awakening the Dreamer. One of the other organizations I'm involved with is a group called the Pachamama Alliance. It was started about 20 years ago because people in the Amazon rainforest were concerned about protecting the rainforest. You know, they call the rainforest the lungs of the planet. Well, you know what happens if your lungs aren't working anymore. You don't live very long. So it's very important that we not only do things locally, but, you know, they say, what is it, think globally, act locally, but we have to be thinking globally, and there's lots to do. So it's great to see so many people out here today for this wonderful event. I'm glad to be here. Thank you. My name is Marty Levin. So if anybody wants to reach me, I've been in touch with Kathy, and you can get together with her.
Anybody else?
It's our last.
Yes, yes.
Very powerful, dealing with the issues and with recommendations in it. So
that's
it's
right.
Really, really much involved with everyone.
That's right.
Someone over here with Will.
Thanks, everyone.